But let's start off by singing together. If you're able, stand with me. Let's sing together. Days of Elijah.
Starting another, so be sure and keep your Sundays free for us.
Amen. Amen. All right. Let's see. Another thing, we'll remember during our prayer time, we need to remember all those in COVID, with the COVID issues. From what I hear this morning, that there's quite a few in Imperial that have been getting it, and that's pretty close to us. So, and I know that we still are on the rise a little bit. We went up at our level to level orange this week. So let's be in prayer for that. and be thinking about what we might can do to just be careful. As we're in here, we haven't at this point said that we have to wear masks or anything, but just be careful. I try not to shake hands. If I come up and I just say hello to you, it's because I'm waiting to see if you do this or not. If you do this, then I'm going to do this. I'm just waiting to make sure because I want you to be comfortable and I want to do what's right, all right? So just be careful and think about what you can do to keep that spread down also, all right? Any other announcements we have this morning before we get started? I guess not. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, today we love you, we praise you, we thank you for another day together. Lord, I thank you for my brothers and sisters that are here. Lord, bless us this day. Speak to our heart, speak to our children. Dear God, we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. I believe, what is it? Kids time? Yep, that's it. All right, kids time! Kids time! Come on, brother. By the way, there's Miss Amber, everybody. Miss Amber, good hand. I was asking about it. She didn't know.
No. With the rest, we know how she feels.
Good morning. You can have a seat on the floor if you want to, or you can squeeze in between. Share any way you want to do it is just perfectly fine. All right, buddy, you can sit with Tony. You can sit right there. That's DeAndre. That's Abby. There's three people. So there, you can sit in a chair over here. Either way you want to. All right. Well, it's good to see you this morning. My name is Pastor Mike. Do you believe that?
No.
Do you believe that my name is Mike? Do you believe that I'm him, or am I someone in disguise?
You're in disguise.
Are you sure? Yes, you are. How do you know I'm Pastor Mike? How do you know I'm Pastor Mike?
I do.
What do you think? Well, because I'm your dad. How do you know I'm your dad? How do you know that I'm not somebody who got surgery and fixed my face? And now I look like this guy named Mike Lewis. Where do you usually see Pastor Mike? Oh, right here, right? And sometimes at the house. Yeah. Does Pastor Mike usually dress like this? Does Pastor Mike usually come up here at kids' time and teach you? Does Pastor Mike usually talk like this? There's a lot of reasons that you can trust that I'm Pastor Mike, right? But are there any reasons that you can trust that God loves you and that he wants to take care of you? Huh. That's a good question. Let's watch this video for just a minute. Mr. Dan, if you would click the light for us there.
About trust. When you trust someone, you believe they'll do what they say they'll do, or they are who they say they are. You trust or have faith that they're telling you the truth. Here's another example of trust. I've had this chair for a really long time. It's strong and sturdy, and it's never broken. Whenever I sit in this chair, it holds me up and I don't fall. So I trust that if I sit in it right now, it'll hold me. Here's another example. Every time I eat a donut, it's sweet and delicious. So I trust that when I take a bite of this, it's gonna be good. And I might get a little bit of a sugar rush. Or maybe there's a person you trust. Maybe there's a person who always shows up when they say they will, or they say they love you, and then act like they love you. So you trust them. Trust or faith is about believing you know the truth because someone or something is consistent. That means it doesn't go changing all of a sudden. So if we're talking about God, trusting him looks like believing he is who he says he is. And God calls himself a lot of different things, like good, strong, kind, loving, our Father, holy, wise, generous, forgiving, and lots more. So when we trust God, we believe him when he says he cares for us. We believe him when he says he has a plan for us. We believe him when he says he forgives us. We believe him when he says we can talk with him. We believe him when he says he is good. We believe him when he says he is always with us. It takes time to build trust, but the good news is God has always and will always be the same. No matter what, God is trustworthy.
This verse right here. This is in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, and it says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. Here's the thing. Did you know that sometimes there are things that happen in our lives that because we're young, we don't know, understand? But you know, sometimes moms and dads understand. Sometimes moms and dads can keep you safe when because they know things that you don't know. Well, God is like that too. In fact, God is like that for grown-ups. There are still things that we don't know. There are things that we're not sure how to handle or what to do. And sometimes things happen in life and they're sad or they're hard or just all kinds of bad things happen sometimes. And we just don't know what to do about it. But God says that He is there to help us through it. Now, He doesn't always just solve every problem right there because sometimes we need to take time to learn and grow. And sometimes bad things help us to grow stronger. Okay? But God does promise that He will always be there with us and He will take us through these things. Okay? So that we will make it through. It won't kill us and it won't keep us down forever. We're going to come out the other side and we're going to be happy again with Him. All right? So trust God because God is always there even when you don't understand things. Okay? All right, let's pray. God, we thank You for today. Lord, bless us in all we do. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, if you would, when you go back to sit with your parents, come by. I'll grab a few of these to hand out, but grab one of these clipboards and grab one of your suckers, and we'll get going. Oh, man, what happened? Got burned. Oh, so one of those fires just coals. Good. Grab me a clipboard.
Come over here.
See, I noticed I'm doing it different this morning. This is just for Trell, so she can get the right sucker this time. Right, Ms. Marilyn? All right, Ms. D, what we got next? I think it's a song. Yes. All right. If you would, if you're able, stand with me and let's sing together. Down at the cross.
Yeah.
each week. So if you know it, just close your eyes or cover them or just don't look. All right, let's try it together. Ready? John chapter 4, verses 34, 35,
and 36.
Jesus said unto them, "My meat is to do the will of him that sent me, and to finish his work. Say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then come the harvest. Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages, and gathereth fruit to life eternal, that both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together." Amen, amen, you may be seated. All right. Have faith in God. If you're able, you can stand with me. Let's sing together. Have faith in God. Luke chapter 18. You know, you preacher, you just do it on the fly, right? Just forget it. computer, forget his notes, forget everything, let's just go for it. How about it? All right. Luke chapter 18 is where we are. And to start off with, I wanted to give you a little bit of an introduction and kind of show you, because what I'm going to show you in chapter 18 is we're going to take the first 30 verses or so, and we're going to put them together. These are parables that Jesus said. And typically we take them as individual things, but if you really, you know, and they're good to do that. I mean, take parables, take verses, take sections, do all that. Look at them individually. Look in depth at what they have to say. And they have a lot of great things to say in there. But sometimes, if you'll pull back and you'll look at what the entire book says, look at the chapters and how they interact with one another. You know, we tend to think of Scripture much like, I guess, the book of Proverbs. You know, where you've got just, to be honest with you, Proverbs are just that. They're Proverbs. You got a proverb here, a proverb there, another proverb after that. They're not necessarily related. If you try to study them and try to relate them, it doesn't work because they're not related. They're just simply good sayings. But we tend to take that idea and we put it to the rest of Scripture, when in reality, Scripture is not like that. When Jesus stood up to preach, he didn't just stand up and put out random things here and there on various topics, just whatever happened to pop in his mind. It's the same with Paul and the rest of them. And especially when they took it, they put it in the Word of God. They put it in there because things work together, because things interact, and they all bring about an understanding of one thing, okay? So to start with this morning, we're in Luke chapter 17, that section before. Jesus took his disciples aside, and he told them that there would be a day to come that they would yearn to see the Son of Man, but it would not come, but trust that the day will come in time. There will be times, he says to them, because he's actually already presented to them that he is going to go into Jerusalem, and when he gets there, things are going to happen. Bad things are going to happen. He's going to be taken from them. So this is happening just before the time that he is taken, okay? The days before he goes in, his triumphal entry and all of that. He's also, during this same time period, raised Lazarus from the dead. Lots of things are going on. And he says to them, listen, we're going to Jerusalem. Something's going to happen. But, of course, they didn't understand. And in fact, it was God who made sure they didn't understand. I mean, imagine if you knew that going into this town, the one you loved more than anything was going to be taken and killed and done like he was done. Would you let him go? Would you pitch a fit? What would you do? It's the same way. So God didn't give them full understanding, but Jesus told them. God blocked their understanding until later on when they began to write the book. And they looked back and said, oh, here's what he meant when he said this. This is what's going on. And he says to them, so when this happens, there's going to be a time that you begin to yearn for the Son of Man. Through this section, he's talked also about when the Son of Man, and you know the Son of Man, that's Jesus, he's talking of himself, when he's going to come back and he's going to make things right again. And he says, there's going to be a day when you yearn for that, but it just doesn't happen. Hard times are going to come. A lot of time is going to happen. All kinds of things are going to happen. And you're going to hit days where you just, with Jesus, wish you'd just come back. Just come back. I long for you. I yearn for you. I want you to come back. I'm tired of this world. I'm tired of everything that goes on here. And you yearn for that. And he says, but even in those times when you yearn, it's not necessarily happening. It's a hard thing. But it's going to come in God's time. And it's going to be when no one expects and no one knows, no one understands. Okay? He does say there at the end, which was a little confusing to me, he said, they will not know the day until they see, actually it said in my translation, the eagles, and another translation says the hawks, but it's talking specifically actually about the vultures in the translation. So there will be a time, you know, a lot of people think they see the deaths that have happened from COVID, they see other things that have happened, great tragedies, great things that have happened in the world, and they think this must be the end. Remember, we've done a sermon on that before, when the disciples themselves, when Jesus said this temple is going to be destroyed, and then when the temple was destroyed, what was it, 60, 70 years? No, it's a little less than that. But anyways, around 70 or so after AD, around that time when the temple was destroyed and Jerusalem began to be scattered and the Israelites and all this began to happen, many of them thought this has to be the end of the world. This has to be the end of all things. You know, Jesus must be coming any time. And that was what? But less than 2,000 years ago. Understand, when people are dying, things are happening, that's going to happen in this world. God will come in His perfect timing. And that last verse, it's a little scary, to be honest with you. Because imagine all the things that we've gone, imagine the things that our parents, our grandparents, and beyond have gone through with the world wars and all the other kind of things that have gone on. Imagine all of those terrible things that have happened, the Holocaust, all the other things, and yet it still wasn't time. But it seems when that time comes, it's going to be something much worse leading into it. And we've talked about that. If you want to know more about that, let me know. We'll talk about end times prophecy together later. But here's what Jesus is saying. So then he enters into chapter 18 here. And he says, then he spoke a parable to them that men always ought to pray and not lose heart, saying, there was a certain woman. There was a certain city, a judge who did not fear God nor regarded men. Now there was a widow in that city, and she came to him saying, get justice for me from my adversary. And he would not for a while, but afterwards he said within himself, though I do not fear God nor regard men, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. First of all, in chapter 18, let's beware of the traps that seek to ensnare us until the time he comes again. Remember, he said he's coming, and remember there's lots of things that are going to happen until that time. Very hard things, things that will cause us to yearn and just wish that he would come. But trust him until that time. Trust that he loves you. Trust that he will get you through whatever the trials, whatever the traps, whatever the things that happen. Trust that he will get you through. And these are things, what we're going to be looking at are parables that are traps. That traps that we can fall into if we're not careful waiting for him to come back. Okay? All right, Miss D, our first trap here that we just read about. It's the parable of the persistent widow. You know, some will lose heart and be as the widow, but be as the widow. Keep seeking till it comes. You know, there are times that some of us, things happen in our lives, whether it's sickness, whether it's sadness, whether it's all kinds of things that happen in this world. And sometimes we just get tired. And sometimes when we get tired, we just stop doing the things we know we ought to do. You know, there's a section of scripture that when I was young, I didn't understand. It said, do not grow weary in doing good. And I thought, how can you grow weary in doing good? How many of you have ever dealt with somebody or some situation for just so long? And you tried to do what was right. You tried to do what was good. But you just get to this point that you're just tired of it. You're just tired of doing good. You're tired of doing the right thing. You just want to tell that person off. You just want to do whatever. And that's a trap. That's a trap that we fall into. Because Christ has not come yet, we fall in this trap of getting weary of the things in this world, the arguments, the issues, the sicknesses, the issues with relationships, all the things that go on in this world. We get so tired and we just grow weary of doing good. We grow weary of doing what is right. But what is the point of what this widow did? This judge, he was not a righteous judge. He was arrogant. He didn't care about people. There was nothing about him that was good. But she kept on and she kept on until finally he said, okay, whatever. Keep you from bugging me to death. I'm going to make it happen. Now the point of this is not to bug Jesus to death. Okay, don't bug God to death with your prayers and your wants. Okay, that's not the point. Okay? The point is that if you continue and the person that you are seeking is trustworthy like God is, if you continue in your prayers, if you continue in doing good, if you continue reading His Word and growing and learning, if you continue in these things, it will come to be. Trust that it will. Don't grow weary. Keep going. Keep looking for that hope that is ahead. And don't grow weary in doing good. Don't grow weary in church. Don't grow weary in reading your Bible. Don't grow weary in your prayers. Trust that He's coming. Don't grow weary and fall away from Him. Alright? Now let's look at our next little parable here. Then the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said. Shall not God avenge His own elect? This is from the previous. Who cried out day and night to Him, though He bears long with them. I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on earth? All right, that ends that passage. You forgive me, I'm not with my notes, so I'm getting a little off track. Now also he spoke this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. He said, two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not as much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat at his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you this, man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. All right. Our next point here, the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. Some begin to get comfortable here. And here they begin to rely on who they are. A couple of these are going to make that point that some people begin to get comfortable here. Let me step out of this just a minute and remind you. Remember last week's sermon. This is not our home. Where is our home? Heaven. If you live, I'll be honest with you, if you're a Christian, and you live in this life, you live here comfortably, probably something's wrong. If you can live comfortable in this world of sin, if you can live comfortable in where we are right now, then something is wrong. Because my friends, if we follow what Scripture says, if we continue with the things that God has said for us to do in prayer, in reaching out and telling others about Christ, in living our lives in such a way that we sacrifice ourselves for others, if we live in that way, this world will be a contradiction to us and we will not be comfortable. But some people begin to get comfortable. And in this case, this person got comfortable by beginning to rely on who he was. You know something, there are some here, some of you here, I have conversations that go two ways a lot of times. I have conversations with people that just can't understand the love and the grace of God. They realize because they see so clearly their own sin in their lives, they see so clearly that they can't understand, they can't fully understand that, man, I messed up again. They can't fully understand that all they need to do is get on their knees and say, God, I'm sorry. God, help me to turn from that. God, help me to do it again. And he will forgive them and he will love them. They tend to keep holding on to this sin. They tend to keep carrying it around with them. But then on the other side of things, there's another type of person. These people come. I'll be honest with you, I have counseling sessions sometimes, and I have other things. And people come, and they sit down before me, and they're there because they want to know what God's Word says, but in their introduction of what's going on, they say, this is going on, but here's what I think we should do, and here's what we need to do, and here's where we need to go, and this is what we need to do. And they rely on their own understanding. They rely on their own faithfulness. They rely on their own whatever it is to lead their way. Like this man, he thinks that living by this law makes him something important and everything is just right, just good because he's doing the things that he thinks that he should do, that he knows he should do. So he relies on himself. My friends, while we wait for Christ, be careful. Be careful. Our next point is going to be interesting. Be careful that we do not begin relying on who we are and what we can do and not turning to God and trusting him for what we need every day. Which leads to our next parable here. Let me read this one. Then they also brought infants. Well, this is not a parable. This actually happened. I'm sorry. Not a parable. This one happened while he was teaching these things. Here's something that happened. He said, then they brought infants to him that he might touch them. But when the disciples saw it, they rebuked them. But Jesus called to him and said, let the little children come to me and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it. All right. Where's the contradiction between what we just saw in the previous parable and what's going on here? What is it that Jesus is saying here? He gives this parable of this man that relies on his own self, the things that he can do, the way that he can think, everything else. He relies on himself for the daily provision. Let me ask you something. Think of your children, okay? Mary Lee, if you just left the house, you didn't bring any more food to the house or anything else, you just left the kids there, they were there by themselves. After a few days, what would happen?
They'd venture out.
They'd venture out or die, right? They would venture out. What would they venture out for? To seek someone to help them, to seek someone to feed them, to seek someone to clothe them, to show, to do whatever these other things, right? Because children understand and they recognize that they need their parents, even though they don't act like they respect them enough. They do need others. They need people to provide their daily provision. They don't know where to get water. They don't know where to get food, especially infants and smaller children. How long would Lindy Rose survive if Amber and I and the others just left? She doesn't know where to get things. She knows how to push the thing on the refrigerator to get some water, but eventually that's going to break. She knows how to turn on the spigot. She knows how to open the refrigerator and there's food there, but at one point all that's gone. She relies on us for her provision. My friends, some begin to grow old and stop seeking provisions daily from God. Just like that man that thought he had it all together. Sometimes we're not like these children. He says, these children, they make up what the kingdom of God is. What is it about them? It's that they seek provision every day. They look to others for blessing. They look to others for provision every single day. And you know, sometimes we get so comfortable in this world because we deny where our citizenship truly is, and we don't, be honest with you, the only way we're comfortable is we're not doing the things that God is commanding us to do anyways. So we get so comfortable in this world that we forget that we need something from Him every day, that we must seek Him to provide for us every day. And we grow old instead of staying childlike. You know, Peter Pan had good advice. Never grow up, especially on this particular point, okay? Seek His provision every day. I understand that you've got a good job. I understand that you have what you need to provide for your family and buy food and you have a good vehicle and you have the things. I understand that. But my friends, understand at any point that can be taken away from you. At any point that can be denied you. It is only God that gives us what we have from day to day. So, don't fall into the trap of growing old and believing that I can do it myself. Continue to seek Him daily for provisions that you need. Now a certain ruler asked Him, saying, "Good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" So Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is, God. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not bear false witness, honor your father and your mother." And he said, "All these things I have kept from my youth." So when Jesus heard these things, he said to him, "You still lack one thing. Sell all that you have and distribute to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me." But when he heard this, he became very sorrowful, for he was very rich. And when Jesus saw that he became very sorrowful, he said, "How hard is it for those who have riches to enter the kingdom of God? For it is easier for camels to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." And those who heard it said, who then can be saved?" But he said, "The things which are impossible with men are possible with God." We've got another man here. A man who holds a certain form of religion. But again, they trust in their own provisions. They trust to pull themselves up by their own bootstraps, to rely on the things that they have put aside, their own money, their wealth, other things that are theirs. And what would happen? You say here as a Christian, you say, "Yes, God is providing for me. I love God. This is wonderful. God takes care of me. He provides for all of my needs. He gives me food. He gives me shelter. He gives me a good vehicle. God is blessing me. I even have money in the bank that I can fall back on. Things are great, things are good. But my friends, what will happen if all that is taken? What will happen if God says to you, I know you have all this provision all stored up, and that's good, because what I want you to do is stop working. I want you to stop doing the things you're doing, and I want you to move somewhere else. I want you to go somewhere else and serve me. I want you to go spread the gospel in another country, in another state, in another place. I want you to go and do something more where this provision will not continue. How many of us, think about that. Think right now, where you are. What if God said to you, I want you to quit your job. I want you to quit everything else. I want you to leave your family. And I want you to go somewhere and serve me. Does that scare you? Why does it scare you? It scares you because we rely on the things that we have. We rely and we find security in what we have in the bank. What we have is our home. What we have in the cupboard. Our steady job. We rely on these things. And that's why it scares us to even imagine that God would say, drop all that and go serve God. So we look at this man and we think, my goodness, he had an opportunity to follow Jesus. And he went, I just gave all my money and then went. Would you? Really? Because there's no difference in then and now. Jesus is just alive now as he was then. So if God says to you, drop it all, leave it all, leave everyone, leave everything, go serve me. That's scary because we're in the same boat as him. We're relying on our security of where we are and what we have, rather than fully trusting that he is our provision. He is our provision. Then Peter said, see, we have left all and followed you. So he said to them, assuredly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or parents or brothers or wife or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who shall not receive many times more in this present time and in the age to come eternal life. Jesus assures the faithful. You know, Peter's the one that's going to do this, right? If you study Scripture, you know the characters, you know who Peter is. You know Peter's the one that's going to see all this going on, and he's going to see this guy go away sorrowful because he's not willing to sacrifice. And Peter's going to be the one that steps up and says, but Jesus, we gave up all to come after you, didn't we? And there's almost a question in there, too. Because Jesus and his disciples, do you think they ate every day? They may not have. They ate when there was provision. There were times, though, that they would travel for a couple of days at a time. There may be some food that may be limited, but they didn't have what we have. I know that. But he steps up and he says, well, Jesus, we gave up all. Maybe he's looking for some assurance. Maybe like us, he's looking for something more. If Jesus called you to drop everything and go, wouldn't you maybe step out and say, Jesus, I gave up all? Just reminding him so then maybe you can get a little bit of that reassurance, right? Maybe we can get a little bit of that reassurance. So is God going to do this? Is Jesus going to reassure him? Oh, yes, he is. Jesus promises the faithful that their service will not be in vain. My friends, if we gave up all that we had, if we sacrificed our security, if we sacrificed all that we had, our bank account, everything else that we had, if we sacrificed that here, Jesus says to us, don't worry, I will provide for your needs, and even if it leads to death, then there is an eternity ahead of you. I promise you that everything that is to come, the hope that is laid before you, is well worth all of the sacrifice that you will do here on earth. And in fact, my friends, that is our calling here. You say, well, it's only the calling of the preachers and the missionaries and the others to go and to do and follow God like this. No, my friends. No. Scripturally, the Christian is one who takes the provisions that they have, the money in the bank, the other things, and uses it to serve and whatever way God leads them. Imagine if, I'm going to throw this out there. Understand, there is nothing wrong with having things that God has blessed you with. There's nothing wrong with having a nice boat and a nice truck and a nice, there's nothing wrong with that. Okay, I'm not saying that at all. But I want you to hear my heart and hear where I'm coming from. What if every Christian in the world, all the followers of Christ, would take this extra that they have and send it to feed those that are in need? Or send it to build wells in places where people walk and travel miles and miles and miles and miles back and forth every day just to get water? Or what if they took that money and they provided a place to live for a family who is destitute and doesn't have anything? What if we took the blessings, the excess that we have, and somehow put it in somewhere to serve? And then, that's not just the end of it, okay? Because that's fine. That's great. There are people all over the world who are not Christians that give all kinds of money to people in need, okay? But there's an extra step that a Christian would do. They would give all this extra. They would give of what they have, of their provision to provide for others. And then they would step up and say, listen, I want you to know, this is not for me. This is nothing more than what God has provided for me, and He asked me to give it to you. So it is He that you turn to. It is He that has blessed you. It is He who has saved you. Can I tell you a little more about how much He loves you? Imagine the impact the church could have in the world if we were willing to do that. Now back to our original point. Jesus has not come yet. I pray that before I get finished speaking, the roof rips off, we hear a trumpet and the clouds roll back. That would be wonderful. I'm one of those people that yearn for that day. I do. I want that day. I want more to know Christ. There's a conviction there because I want more to know Christ. I want more to seek Him. I want more to find Him. But at the same time, sometimes I get tired and I yearn for Him to come. I want Him to come. I want to be taken up into His arms. This is what I want. And I pray that happens before I get through speaking. But my friends, it has not happened so far. And Jesus says that it's not going to always happen when you yearn for it. It's going to happen in His time, but it is not yet. So until that time, what will you do? Will you grow weary? Fall into the trap of growing weary? Will you fall into the trap of being comfortable in this world? Maybe comfortable because you seem to be living the right life and doing the right things, so maybe you can make it right. Or maybe you go comfortable in this world such that you have a good bank account, you have something to fall back on, so you have some security here, so you begin to grow comfortable in this world. Maybe we grow old and forget that we need Him every single day. And thus comes our struggle to pray every day. Well, I forgot to pray. I prayed a few days. Why? Because we don't truly understand that we have to have provision from Him every day to live. Do we fall into those traps? Do we rely on who we are, what we have? Are we comfortable here? If so, my friends, imagine what life could be. Imagine what eternity will be if we just give all of that up. Step out into His arms. Step into His daily provision and trust Him every day. Seek Him every day. Read about Him every day. Praise Him. Worship Him every day. Please, my friends, don't grow weary. I know He hasn't come yet. I know that hard times have come and more hard times will come. I know. But please don't grow weary. He has promised us that He will come. And my friends, He is trustworthy, just like we told the children. They knew that I was the pastor because I show up here every week at this time. I stand up here before them every week at this time. I dress kind of like this every week. I speak like this every week. I'm consistent. I'm steady. It's every week to them, so they trust me in who I am. I'm asking you to trust Him in who He is, because though we haven't seen Him yet, has He ever lied to you? Has He ever led you astray? Has He ever forgotten about you? No, He never has. So trust That even though it hasn't happened yet, though we don't understand it, we're like little children, we don't understand the time or when it will be or why He's continuing to wait. We don't understand it, but trust Him every day. Seek Him every day. And then one day, we'll fall on our knees and we'll call out to the Father, and there'll be no need because the clouds will roll back. He'll reach out His hand and He'll pull us. Trust. Trust every day. Ask Him for His provision every day. Because He is trustworthy. Lord God, this morning I ask, dear God, that You provide for us this day. Lord, that You would provide our encouragement, Lord. You provide our sustenance. You provide a home, dear God. You provide shelter and clothing and the things that we need, dear God. Lord, I ask that You provide for our spiritual hearts, dear God. I ask that You provide, dear God, encouragement to wait, strength, dear God, to wait for that day till You come. And Lord, grow our faith that, Lord, as we trust You day to day, Lord, we will trust more and more that that day is coming. That hope that is set before us, dear God, it is coming. And Lord God, when it comes, it will be well worth all of the pain, all of the sorrow, the things that we suffer in this world. But dear God, even now, help us to trust You that, Lord, when those things come, You'll be with us here. Lord God, You will provide and get us through. Lord, I saw something this week that was interesting, dear God. Lord, You did not take away the sea, Lord. You instead, Lord, You opened it up before Your people. Lord, there are times that we have to walk through scary things. But God, You are with us. And that means You will provide. Lord, make us like children. Help us to seek You every day, Lord, for Your provision. And it's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. If you're able, stand with me. Let's sing our closing song together, the family of God.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family.